Thank you both, Helen and Jenny, for covering my disorganisation, hopefully. Now I'm set up and ready to go. I feel like I have a lot to cover, but I've been inspired this morning by how much, and this afternoon by how much everybody has managed to cover in 20 minutes, so hopefully we'll get through it. I'm going to talk about a little bit about research with sexually exploited young women, about how relationships and the lack of them can pose a risk, but how supportive and strong relationships can mitigate risk. And I want to start with making the case that I think matters to all of us in this room about hearing voices. There is a really unattractive turn, I think, in social policy and research at the moment to privilege counting and numbers as the only way of knowing. And it means that we don't hear voices. It means that they're dismissed as anecdata. And that we don't hear the experience and expertise of those that work with children, young people, and with adults too. What we call practice-based evidence, but that is also a form of evidence and a form of knowledge that we should be respecting. So, I'm going to start with the voice of a young woman who I think talks really powerfully for her about how, in her route into sexual exploitation from local authority care, the absence of relationships to protect and sustain her had been so key. And when she says, where are they, where are they, she's talking about all of those professionals involved with her life from a range of different agencies who were saying that she was unable to make decisions about her life until she was 21 because she couldn't be understood as an adult, and she felt that they didn't understand everything else that she'd managed, which was far more significant than whether or not she could manage her own weekly allowance. Okay, so a little bit about the research then. My background is in working in what specialist children's home that was set up as a therapeutic residential unit specifically for sexually exploited young women that were already in local authority care. And so what the research drew from that is this is building on practice-based evidence, is building on what we could see and what we knew from working with sexually exploited young women. And we know that young people from local authority care are disproportionately represented in those that are sexually exploited. We know that the risk factors that are concentrated often in young people who are in care, and we know that there are links with sexual exploitation of boys too. But it seemed to be something that at the time was talked about as just known, but nobody really understood exactly what those routes looked like. There was some research by Maggie O'Neill and by Jenny too that talked about the importance of emotions, about not just focusing on the practical and material aspects of young people's lives. And it's what Maggie O'Neill talks about as having in research a politics of feeling, that we prioritise the looking at and the exploring of emotions as well as life events when we're understanding lived experience. So, life history interviews with 14 young women, aged 17 to 33. Somebody has said to me once before that the age of 33 is somewhat optimistic to be called young. Now I'm well past that, I understand more why that was said. But the women all identified as wanting to talk about their experiences of local authority care, and that they were still relating to young women that were in care, even though that they understood that they were past some of that stage themselves. And it was an interview that started with a single narrative-inducing question: can you tell me about your experience of care and your route into sexual exploitation? And up halfway through, when the themes of body and self emerged as significant, we did arts workshops with over 40 women, not all of whom had been in care and not all of whom would fit even into my very broad definition of young, but exploring what their relationship with their body and their sense of self looked like and felt like. And so I'm not going to talk to you about all of the backgrounds of the young women. I don't think it will come as a surprise to any of us to say that most of them had some experience of sexual and physical abuse. Mostly what they talked about was a feeling unloved and feeling unvalued and feeling abandoned, and that their lives were characterised by loss, and the most important losses were those of people and relationships. And these are some of the young women's voices. This is Jo talking about how in children's homes you get what used to one lot of staff and then they change, and then you've got someone other set of staff comes on and they might have a different approach and you've got to change again. And somebody was talking this morning about fitting in, and I think that this is part of this, this constant reinvention of who you think you are to fit in. And Christina talking about feeling worthless, that she was moved around from placement to placement with no consultation about where she might live, and perhaps most powerfully from Becky, when she talks about this idea of going out looking for love, about seeing people that feel safe and supported in relationships, and that that's what she was looking for when she went out. So when Carlene said this morning that we need to question some of young people's friendships and what they look like, what the young women were saying was that when they were running away, they were trying to form relationships that felt good, that felt healthy, that felt supportive. And of course, often, the motives of those adults that were forming relationships with them were not good or supportive. This is an image created by a 17-year-old young woman in the arts workshop where she talked about the importance of her family in enabling her to move away from all of the networks of sexual exploitation that she was involved in. And she says, I thought I was losing them. They were getting further and further away from me because she couldn't confide in them. She couldn't talk to them about where she was going at night and what was going on for her. But with their love and support, I have come through this nightmare. And this was a reflection on what enabled her to move away from the networks of sexual exploitation. So a little bit about the concept of the relational self that the young women's experiences spoke to. It was developed by US psychologist Carol Gilligan to capture the way in which particularly women's sense of identity is socialised on building and maintaining relationships with others, that a measure of femininity is whether or not we get on with people. It's been developed, I think, in a really interesting way by a US philosopher called Susan Bryson, where she talked about how the self is relational and violence and abuse disrupt that. So that when you experience violence and abuse, it isn't just a violation of your body and yourself, but it's a violation of relationships. And I think that's really important too, where we're talking about abusers as being someone that, that is how you have a relationship with, as being a parent, as being a carer, as being a partner, a boyfriend, that we might understand as a pimp, but as somebody that the young person feels a violation of trust with. And two issues linked to this too. One, about this sense of self was sexualized, that young women perceived that the only way professionals responded to them was about their sexual behavior, that nobody was interested when I joined the football team or I went to school every day for 3 weeks, but suddenly if they think that I've been raped or they think that I'm having sex with an older man, then I've got social workers at my door. And also, the ways in which the self is embodied, that experiences of abuse are experienced through the body, that it is the body that is moved around from placement to placement. It is the body which is the way in which others responded to the young women too. So, if young women had developed a series of dissociative measures to cope with sexual abuse, then the process that meant that they were cut off from their bodies, that they felt like they switched off from it, then the process of allowing strangers access to the body, whether it's at a party or whether it's more formally on a street corner where somebody is paying, was much easier because that relationship with the body was already disrupted. And finally, the issue about transactional relationships, that young women talked about this idea that people were paid to care. So there is always a way in which any kind of affection involves getting something material, not emotional, back. And that's a challenge, of course, for all kinds of substitute care, where young people might be bringing their perceptions about people being care. It's just a job, people not caring for me, to their relationships. Okay, this is an image by a young woman. This is not the young woman. This was posed for by a model, of what she wanted to say about her experience of sexual abuse. And she's talking here about the abuses of her body, but she's also talking about the relationship. These are the words that her stepfather said to her. You're so special. It's something I do to show that I care. It's our little secret. Now, part of these, we know that these are some of the manipulative techniques used by abusers, but what she's alerting us to is the way in which abuse is also a violation of relationships as well as bodies. Okay, and this is Susan Bryson, I think, talking about something really important about the ways in which violence undoes those relationships, but in the process of overcoming it, it can also be rebuilt through them. And that's what I wanted to talk about in terms of what it looks like in practice. This is a project called Safe Choices that is a specialist support project for sexually exploited young women. It's a partnership between the Children's Society and NIA, who are a feminist organisation that work on all forms of violence against women. And they take an explicitly gender-informed approach to working with young women. So there's a focus on having conversations with young people about what is gender, what do gendered expectations look like, how are men and women positioned in society. And alongside this, there are discussions of identity, of consent, of relationships, of girls in gangs, of offending and of sexual exploitation and violence. One of the projects works specifically with young people leaving care and custody, and in both these strands there is both group and one-to-one work with young women and training for professionals that goes alongside that. The reason that I'm talking about them is that we are evaluating two of their projects. One of them is for the young women leaving care and custody. And what is really clear, even at these very early stages of our evaluations, is that what the workers are providing in terms of the specialist support is as a one-stop person. So we talk a lot now about the one-stop shop, right? Getting all services under one roof. And actually what's going on is that this is a slightly different variation on that. This is a worker that negotiates with all of those agencies. Partly that's because the cuts to services mean that the workers are doing more and more advocacy and more than they anticipated. But also it tells us about the strength of that relationship, that's what's necessary for young people's rights to be realised, is that somebody can do that negotiation. And this is from one of the young women in Holloway, where she talks about the importance of the group work being that she can connect with others, that she can understand others' perspectives. And when she was telling me this, she was saying that I didn't know what I would find when I came into this group, and I didn't think I wanted to talk about this anywhere else. But the most important thing that I learned was not just about the content, but it was about trying to negotiate with somebody else what they thought in terms of what I thought as well, and where we disagreed. Another young woman said to me that the best thing about Safe Choices was the worker, because we get along really well. I trust her to tell me things, and she's helped me a lot. And one of the practitioners that we interviewed said that they thought that the whole success of the project was what it offered in terms of containment for young women, that it was all about the quality of that relationship between the worker and young women, and that's what distinguished it from other support services that were available too. Okay, so I wanted to shift somewhere slightly different from talking about the importance of this relational self. Just to finish, and perhaps to have some questions for us to go away thinking about. And that's to talk about some research on sexual consent that we did for the Office of the Children's Commissioner. Sue mentioned it this morning, it was part of the inquiry into sexual exploitation. We had an online survey of nearly 500 young people and focus groups and interviews with another 110. And in them, we created videos that were scenarios, a young person talking to a camera, a young actor talking to a camera about a scenario that would legally constitute rape, but in circumstances that muddied that. So there was alcohol involved in one of the scenarios, there was a long-term relationship in another one, others involved meeting strangers in bars and waking up the next morning not being sure what happened. In another scenario, a young woman was exchanging sex in relation for a bed in circumstances which were clearly coercive as she was describing them. And the young people were asked whether or not they thought somebody had given consent, whether someone had got it, whether the sex was okay, and whether or not something counted as rape. And what we found was that young people understand the idea of consent. They can talk about this, they can say it's permission, it's approval, it's making sure the other person wants to, it's mutuality. But then when you ask them about these specific scenarios that say, right, let's apply that to real life, then their understandings become less clear. And they focus very much on whether or not consent was given, rather than whether or not somebody had sought consent. And of course, under the Sexual Offences Act, the person getting consent is required to do that. The requirement is to show that reasonable steps were taken to get consent. And what happens is that these really gendered ideas about victim blame start hitting what young people think about consent. So young women's actions are constantly under scrutiny. Did she wear that top because she thought it made her breasts look good? Did she accept that drink even though she knew he would want something? Did she say yes to sleeping on that bed for the night even though she knew that she would have to give him oral sex? All of those are decisions which make young women culpable for what happens to them subsequently.
3 minutes, Maddie.
Okay, great, thank you. And that all links to an alive and kicking sexual double standard. So in every region of young people where we talked to, they said that sexually active young women were sluts, hoes, skets, slags, but sexually active young men, they were dons, they were players, they were legends, they were heroes. And it tied into this idea of man points, that the most successful way that a boy can get man points, can be popular amongst his peers, is to have sex. It's not the only way, but actually getting young women to have sex with you and to send you sexts and to otherwise engage with flirting with you or whatever, those are ways in which young men can be successful. As I said, the focus was always on whether or not consent was given. We also asked about pornography. It was the subject about which young people had the most to say, were the most animated. It emerged as a really significant theme in their lives. When we asked them about it, they said, we're not looking for information about sex. It's entertainment. Everybody watches it. Okay, well, what is it that you get out of watching pornography? Oh, well, I get tips about how to do it. So it is a source of information. But it's a source of information in sex that very rarely has any intimacy or mutuality in it. And that's really important because our recommendation, key recommendation from this research, is that we shift the conversations about consent from the focus being on giving, on whether or not somebody said no, to whether or not consent was got. It actually takes us into line with where the law is, certainly in England and Wales. And so we suggest that we should be looking for an enthusiastic yes, that the idea about sex should be, does that person want to have sex with you? And can you tell it in their body? Does it feel like there's enthusiasm and desire and pleasure there? And that leads me to thinking, if we think about sex in this way, if we translate this concept of consent as about mutuality into the idea that sex is a relational encounter involving somebody else wanting to have sex with you, if we say that it is about selves that are relational and want to build relationships and connections with others, does that change how we negotiate consent? And I think for conversations with young people, it makes me want to ask, can that help us translate the concept of consent into real life experience? Can that bridge this gap between this abstract intellectual understanding of what consent is and then what it might look like in everyday life? Okay, that's me done. Thank you.